I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. With me is Nick Wilkie from the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living, and he's going to be our co-host today. With my special guest today is Shelley Madore. She works in the implementation office for the Olmstead Plan, and that's going to be a great segment. It's been a while since we've talked to Shelley, and I'm interested in getting caught up. Nick, who's your guest today?
So my guest today, Mark, is a young colleague of mine named Michael Sack. I got to know Michael a number of years ago. He was actually my first guest on Disability Viewpoints when I first started co-hosting. And that was just yesterday, as you know.
Yes.
He started a new project called the Minneapolis Sidewalk Repair Hunters. And this has been a great opportunity to address some sidewalks that need repair and improve access for people with disabilities. So
great.
I'm really excited to have him back on.
Because if you're ever disabled, we're going to have the most problem in the city, probably with the sidewalk. So yep. People don't realize what an important thing that is, but we're going to learn more in just a few minutes. So yep. We have all that and more coming up today on Disability Viewpoints. Please stay tuned. Nick Wilkie and I will be right back.
Hello, and welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. I'm your co-host this month. My name is Nicholas Wilkie. I work for the Center for Independent Living in St. Paul. And back on the on Disability Viewpoints with me today is my friend and colleague, Michael Sack. I have known Michael for a long, long time. In fact, he actually dates back to, he helped me do my very first segment on Disability Viewpoints. And that was like, you know, a year ago, buddy. So I'm really excited. I'm really excited to have you back on the show, Michael. And today we're going to be talking about one of your new projects, which is called the Minneapolis Sidewalk Repair Hunters. And we're going to get into those questions. Right now, Michael lives in Minneapolis. He's a graduate of Minneapolis Transition Plus. Some other things that I know about Michael is he loves baseball, and also works at Rise in Bloomington. Is that right, buddy?
Yeah. Still?
Okay. Awesome. And so here we go. Let's see what Michael has to say about his new project. So, Michael, without wasting any more time, how did Minneapolis Sidewalk Repair Hunters start?
Thanks for asking. Back in 2020, I recorded a very inaccessible curb cut on my block using the City of Minneapolis website to no avail. The sidewalk leading up to the cutout was altered, probably from utility work. Last May, I decided to take pictures of the area and send a description to my city council member at the time, and within 3 weeks, it was fixed. I realized that there were probably a lot more sidewalk inadequacies in the city. So on June 24th, I started the group on Facebook.
That's awesome, man. So the second question I have is, what is the main objective of the Minneapolis Sidewalk Repair Hunters and the movement?
Minneapolis Sidewalk Repair Hunters is a community-led effort that asks residents and visitors to report inaccessible paths that could impede those who use wheelchairs, other mobility devices, strollers, and frankly, everyday pedestrians. In addition, the platform gives people a chance to discuss disability-related issues and how to improve them. We then compile all the reports and submit a document summarizing problem areas to the city every month or so.
That's awesome. So, Michael, moving on to my next question, what kind of inaccessible sidewalks should be reported?
Good question. Early on in the pandemic, while taking more walks than usual, I realized that Minneapolis has lots of uneven sidewalks that should be fixed. Therefore, the community should report sidewalks that are not lined up with each other, which results in creating a decent size bump. Also, any curb cut that has an excessive dip or inadequate cutout, or if a sidewalk leading up to it is just not there. One other obstruction that should be reported is if a pole or bush is blocking a path.
Nice. So with that being said, what ways can the community report a deficient path?
They should either join our Facebook group, connect with us through our website, or send us an email describing the area in question. For anyone who wants to submit a report, we ask them to send the address, description, and a picture of the insufficient area for a visualization.
Awesome. So, Michael, what is the early, what's the easiest way for individuals to learn more about this effort?
We invite everybody to check out our website, www.mplssrh.org. On there, you will find plenty of information about our effort, how we started, visual examples of problem areas, an opportunity where you can volunteer, and an audio description about this movement.
That's fantastic. Are Minneapolis sidewalk repair hunters on social media? I think they are.
Yeah. We definitely are. That's how the movement all started. People who want to follow Minneapolis sidewalk repair hunters or partake can find us on Facebook at LinkedIn. Posting on Facebook is probably the fastest way to report an obstruction. You can find the group at facebook.com/group/sidewalkhunters. I should note that we don't accept snow obstruction reports, because in reality, the entire city would be reported all at once, and the city does not have any department that efficiently shovels as of now, although they can find residents.
That's great to know, Michael. It's great to know. And I appreciate that. And personally for me, I think St. Paul needs a site just like this. So the last question I've got for you, Michael, what are a couple changes that you want the city of Minneapolis to make in repairing sidewalks?
There are a couple. One major change that I would like the city to make is to find a way to install new sidewalks without having residents pay the bill. I would recommend budgeting a certain amount each year to replace paths. Another thing that I would like to see Minneapolis do is revamp their online reporting system to provide residents and guests of the city a more efficient and reliable way to send in problem areas. Lastly, Minneapolis could look into creating a department within Public Works that searches for sidewalks that lack accessibility and shortly thereafter start the process of pouring concrete for a new and improved pavement.
That would be awesome. Those are great suggestions, Mark. I, for one, have been absolutely amazed by the output that you guys have done. You know, I congratulate you on this effort, Michael. And, you know, if anybody wants to see more, look up Sidewalk Repair Hunters on Facebook, and reference the website as well. Michael, I want to thank you for being with us again today.
And
I'd love to have you back again, man. Maybe to talk about, you know, how many reports have been talked about, because I know you've got those coming out on a regular basis. Thanks so much, Mike, and we'll talk again soon.
Hi, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. My special guest today is an old friend of ours, Shelley Madore, who's done a lot of great things in Minnesota. She's been in political office. She's been a caregiver for the disabled. She's done a lot of great things. And now she's working for the Olmstead Implementation Office. Now, let me give you a little background about the Olmstead policy. Well, back when I was on the state council, and it sounds like a long time ago, it really wasn't. The Olmstead policy came into effect. Judge Donovan Frank brought that to fruition. Mm-hmm. And it went on in Minnesota, and then it seemed to me they had to redo it for one reason or another in Minnesota. And Donovan Frank took a look at it again, and they got it rolling. And then the implementation office came into effect. And it's to help the disabled live even more normal lives than we would have had we not had this, really, in so many words. But it encompasses a lot of things, and it is not part of the ADA. The ADA is still a federal law. There's a differentiation there. But it's now time to welcome Shelley Madore as our special guest today, because she does work in the Office of Implementation for the Olmstead Policy. And so, Lauder, take it away from here. Welcome, Shelley.
Hi, Mark. It's good to be here today. Thank you for inviting me.
Good to have you. So, tell us what the Olmstead Implementation Office is and what it does.
Thanks, Mark. That's a great question. The Olmstead Implementation Office was established as part of the Olmstead Plan in 2015. Our office is set up to support people with disabilities, to not only help to build a Minnesota Olmstead Plan, but to also become aware of how state agencies are supporting efforts for people with disabilities in Minnesota. And I'd like to point out that Minnesota is a very unique state in that we are the only office in the entire United States that works to specifically support an Olmstead Plan. And all 50 states are required to have a plan.
So what is the Olmstead Plan then? Mm-hmm.
The Olmstead Plan is a federally required document that came out of a 1999 decision by the Supreme Court that said all people with disabilities are required to have access to community-based services. And services where they wish to live, where they wish to work, where they wish to have their leisure time. And what had been happening prior to that is that many states offered you two options for living and working and having access to those community-based services, this group home or that group home. And what the Olmstead Plan, the decision that came from the Supreme Court in 1999 said, is that is not acceptable. So Minnesota, we had a lawsuit, and it escalated to the point where we had to have a court monitor come in. And under that monitor time period, we had the Minnesota Olmstead Plan developed. So it was primarily focused on issues that arose in the lawsuit that talked about restraints and other areas where people with disabilities were not feeling like they could be included in the community. And today we are on our sixth revision of plan, where we have created new goals for transportation, for housing, for access to informed choice, employment, and we have 12 state agencies that we work with. And the subcabinet committee, the subcabinet meets quarterly, and then monthly we have a group called the Leadership Forum that specifically works to develop and improve and evolve the Minnesota Olmstead Plan.
So that kind of sums up why we have it, because it encompasses all those things. Yes. How often then is it reviewed, seen on our fifth revision?
We provide the subcabinet leaders with a quarterly report, and we break out all of our goals throughout the year, and then we publish those results annually. And as a matter of fact, in just a couple of weeks at our April subcabinet meeting, the new plan will be showcased to the community.
Do other states have this type of a plan? And if they do, is there a chance to have a national Olmstead plan? The states that are included, connected.
That's a great question.
Because I think we could. The reason I'm saying this, I think we could get our way into the White House.
Mm-hmm. I think you're right. I think the Centers for Independent Living has done an awful lot of work to talk about how we need to have national set standards. However, right now, most of the states and the way that the Supreme Court decision was written is that most of the states control that the implementation of their Olmstead plan. They can focus on one area. The community-based supports were primarily for housing. And so a lot of the states are focusing on that. However, Minnesota has become a national leader. The last year, I have developed a brand new website that takes into account not only the work that the subcabinet does, but all of the different agencies. We are engaging in regular communication through social media, our website presence, and community-based meetings. Of course, right now, they're all virtual because that's the way we're operating.
But you'd rather be in person, wouldn't you?
Of course I would. But we're trying to do our best, get our best outreach right now to be able to get people from across the state. And when most people saw using technology as difficult, we saw it in my office as an opportunity to engage. So we have done a concerted effort to get out there and communicate with folks throughout the state.
Right. And how did you get involved? Can we ask that?
So I started as a community organizer for special education students. My first little foray into this environment of advocacy was the development of a group called Punkers. And it was Parents Urgently Need to Know.
Yeah.
And it was set up to help special education parents understand IEPs, how special education works. From there, I got involved. I took a partners in policymaking class. Our good friend Colleen Wick, Dr. Wick, took that class. And from there, kind of gave me a little kick in the shorts that said, hey, you've got experience here. You should be at the legislature. So then I ran for office and was elected in the Burnsville Apple Valley area. And then after that. Mm-hmm, that's where we first met, as a matter of fact. And then from there, I worked for 9 years with the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living here in St. Paul. And that work was, I was an executive board member there. So we worked on developing new tools to be able to promote independent living. We hosted the Disability Hub at the time. It was called the Disability Linkage Line. And then we developed new outreach to work more collaboratively with our other statewide agencies. And Jesse Bethy Gomez-Bethke right now is working as the executive director there. And he has continued that work and tremendous effort.
You know, when I was in the Minnesota State Council, that linkage line was inducted in then. And so that's about the same time we all got connected. And so that worked out well. So let's say this was January 1, even though it's not.
Yes.
And we had, what can we look forward to in the coming year out of the Olmstead Implementation Office?
Well, we have just started, now that we've worked out the issues about the different platforms and trying to create a very inclusive environment for people to be able to participate. So we have a new series called Lunch and Learn, where we'll be bringing state leaders in for an hour for the community to ask questions.
And then you feed us lunch too?
No, I wish. Now I can't give you lunch virtually. I wish I could. But we're looking at doing that. We have also engaged in doing a lot of outreach to help people learn about the Olmstead Plan and participating in questionnaires and surveys and focus groups about the plan. We also have 5 work groups that are public-private enterprises. So we're looking to build our next, we just finished our first cohort group, and our next group, we're looking at increasing our numbers of people with disabilities to serve on those work groups. Great. So we have a work group for, can I list the work groups?
We have
juvenile justice. Yep. Juvenile justice and special education. We have housing. We have employment. We have the prevention of abuse and neglect. And then we also have a specialty group of state leaders to help identify new data to support some potential new goals for the Minnesota Olmstead Plan. So we're very busy this upcoming year, offering as much opportunity for people to get as engaged as they want to.
Okay, I got a couple questions for you before we go.
All
this COVID trouble we've had, does the Olmstead Implementation Office ever see getting involved as far as educating disability with COVID? And then also my second question is, it seems to me like we have, 37 or 38 people retiring from the legislature this year here in Minnesota. We're always going up and saying what our name is on Community Tuesday and educating, telling them. Do you feel that you could bring a politician in of either party and you could educate them right as your groups are meeting?
Mm-hmm. That is actually something that we're looking forward to doing this upcoming year. So if it's not what we're calling lunch and learn, we are looking at having community meetings where we bring legislators in. Well, my office, once the election cycle has been determined and we're looking at our legislators in January, my office will be outreaching to all of them. You know, one of the things we hear all the time is, I don't know anybody with a disability. I don't understand why people with disabilities are complaining. Don't they?
Everybody has one. There, some are hidden, some are out there. You know, and the other thing is, it'd be good for you, because if you want to get a bill started, you could at least start to let them, here's what we're thinking about. And then,
well, now, I can't advocate for bills, Mark. However, I can make sure that legislators understand the impact of some of those decisions that they're making.
That's what
we support the state agencies in doing that. So a little behind the scenes for me, but I think it's good work.
Well, with you behind the wheel, we know it'll be great. We got about 2 minutes to go. Any final thought you might have? Anything we missed?
No, I just really, number one, I'm just so grateful for the invite to be a part of this, show. But I encourage everyone to please go out to our website. It's mn.gov/Olmstead with an A. We are not Olmstead County.
Nope.
We have nothing to do with Olmstead County except to support people with disabilities
who
live there. And you can sign up. You can learn all about our activities. Sign up for our newsletter. Participate in polls. Participate in surveys on any of the work groups that we are hosting. We have an opportunity for people to give us their input about where they would like to see the work groups focus. So there's lots of opportunities for people with disabilities to get in around the table. And, you know, if we want to have a passion here of nothing about us without us, then we all need to show up.
Okay.
And we need to have people show up.
Thanks for being with us, Shelley. We'll be back with more Disability Viewpoints in just a moment.
Thank you.
Well, that's going to do it for another edition of Disability Viewpoints. I certainly want to thank Shelley Madore for taking the time out of her busy schedule to help us understand what the Olmstead Plan is all about, telling us about her duties in the implementation office. It's to help disabled people live even more normal lives than they would if they didn't have this Olmstead plan. And so we want also people to know and differentiate the ADA is a federal law. It is really not part of the Olmstead plan. So we want people to know that at home. But it was great seeing Shelley again. And I know Nick enjoyed that too. And we enjoyed hearing from Michael Sack on the Sidewalk organization. And Nick, let's get your response on what happened today and disability viewpoints.
Yeah, so like you said, Mark, just a real pleasure to have Michael Sack back on the show and hear about the work that he and the community are doing with Minneapolis Sidewalk Repair Hunters. Check that group out on Facebook. I'm even more excited to hear that the turnaround time for the city of Minneapolis to make some of those repairs has been a lot faster. That's just good to hear. And again, Mark, thank you for giving us a forum to address some of this stuff. It's so important.
Well, you know, Nick, I didn't do it alone. It took a bunch of us to do it, and you were in on there. And so it's not thank you to me, it's thank you to all of us for making this work, and thank you to SPN and guys like Steve Brunsberg and Terry who are here day in and day out trying to make this work. Without them, there wouldn't be disability viewpoints. It is a forum for the disabled. That's what I wanted, and I wanted to continue. And I think we're going to do that. 25 years only seems like yesterday, so we might as well go out and do some more. So with your help, we'll get that done. So thanks for being here today. More importantly, thanks to the viewers for watching at home. We'll see you next time on Disability Viewpoints, and thanks for helping us celebrate our 25th year. We'll hope you keep watching. Thanks. Bye for now.